first discussion, which is country-wise sesame crop review and outlook. The moderator of the session is Mr. Sandeep Bhura from Om India Trading Company Limited. We have 9 panelists, and the way in which we would organize this is that we will call each speaker and give them 5 to 6 minutes. And once they finish their presentation, they can go back and sit down. Once all the presentations are over, we will put the chairs and ask the people to come on the stage, and we will have only the discussions during that time. Right? So I request all the speakers who are part of this session, please stick to your time, 5 to 6 minutes each, so that we can have more time for discussion. With that, I call upon our first speaker from Brazil, Mr. Pedro Sesler from Arbasa Alimentos, to come and speak on what has been the status of Brazil crop in 2022. A round of applause for Mr. Pedro as he comes.
Morning. Yeah, I got to just make this a little taller. Well, it was very nice of the World Sesame Convention to invite us to speak on Brazil. I believe this is the first time that sesame in Brazil are together in a panel for the first time that it ever happened. And it strikes me because we all know that sesame is such an ancient seed, one of the oldest, to be honest, right? And it's being mentioned as the Bible, the Quran, the Torah, and all these ancient books. But I'll tell you what's not being mentioned in such a long time, Brazil. Brazil is quite young, especially when it comes to sesame production. But for some reason, we're all here together to hear both of Brazil and sesame. And I'm here to explain to you why that is happening right now. Okay, got it. All right. So Brazil, as all of you know, is the green country behind me. And we've been growing sesame, not forever, but we've always had sesame for the last 30, 20 years. But it's only been a production that is very, very small, so not exactly significant for us to be brought in the world stage. We've had sesame productions that will be anything around 1,000 metric tons a year. And in the last 10 years, we've been exporting 1,000, 1,500, 2,000, to the point that we are today. Now, we are a country that has a 240 million population, being the 7th in the world. Nigeria is probably going to pass us in the next 5 years, so kudos to you. And then we also have a total area that makes us 5th in the planet, and that's not going to change. But with the population ratio to the area, it's only 2.5% of the population, leaving us with a lot of land and a lot of people with the expertise for growing agriculture products. Now, we've got questions all the time whether, well, are we a powerhouse in agriculture? Yes. Do we have the capabilities of growing all the sesame that the planet may want to? I wouldn't go so far, but we do have capabilities of doing a lot of sesame. But do we have the will to do that? The answer is depends. From what we can see right now, the answer is no, but I'm going to get to it in a second. Brief numbers to you in a nutshell. We are a country that does anything between 55 to 75 metric tons of production a year. We have a domestic market that is being bearish, growing, upgrading of 15,000 metric tons every year. Last year was a little less. The year before that was also a little less. And this is including whole sesame, natural seeds, black seeds, tahini, you name it. All the use. So big country, but not a huge domestic market. But again, this is going up. We don't have the specific numbers. With all of that being said, and the point I'm trying to make is that these numbers that you see in front of me are for exports. So if you go back only 6 years, we were doing 1,500 metric tons a year for exports. The year after that, we did 19. And then a year after that, well, 50% more, but still 3,000 metric tons. For a lot of you, this is nothing. For us, it's 50% more. But then in 2019, we had a little more friction in international market that made us go to our farmers and say, hey, why don't you try this seed that's called sesame? They're like, guys are like, oh, sesame, I've heard of it, but I don't know what it is. And this is only 3 years ago. And then in 2020, we had India entering the room. Basically, we had both of our governments shaking hands together in India in a ceremony in early January 2020, where India and Brazil signed an agreement where they agreed that, look, now we want to import sesame from Brazil, so whatever you produce, should you have the right price, India will be able to import it. And on the other side, Brazil is also going to be importing all the products from India. What did that do to the market? Well, you tell me. Look at the graphic. Whenever China or India or countries with such big potential enter a market, it disrupts to a certain level. And it really did that to sesame in Brazil. Now, just to be clear, I pull out the numbers and I make, well, but how much did really India really impacted? It's right there. In 2020, in the first year where India entered, as much as we increased threefold, it was only 26% of our shares of exports. So it was pretty big, but it's still concentrated in 1/4 of all the exports. And then the next year, India really not really import much from Brazil, but I guess didn't really import much from anywhere else. But fortunately for us, we diversified, and we got a very fragmented international market at the moment. In 2020, the high point up, so we exported 72,000 tons. But the year after that, we had a slightly correction. And that means that we had a big push to tell our farmers to, look, plant it, we're going to pay it to you, everybody's going to buy it. But the following year, we had a like with expectations met international market, so we decreased a little bit, where it leveled. And this is going forward to 2022. We don't expect this to go up back up again, because, again, we have the space, the capabilities, and the machines to do it. But the drivers of sesame productions in Brazil, and so is for this whole planet, is the price. If we have the right price internationally, we have the right means to go to our farmers, give them contracts, and then stimulate them to grow sesame for us. But if the drivers are not going that way, then our farmers are going to have all the other crops that they have. Sunflower, sorghum, corn. We do have to fight for cultures. There's a crop competition to every single piece of land that we can find. And they're using every single one of them. So if sesame can compete with those cultures, we're good. We're going to continue rising. If it cannot, due to international market, then most likely it's going to be stabilizing. The kinds of sesame that we do, if you are familiar with it or not, I don't believe that everyone has known Brazilian sesame yet, but 95%, and this has been growing more and more of the market share, is white Brazilian sesame, also known as K3. For those of you who've worked with it. And all the other varieties, and we have varieties that have been developed by Embrapa, the Brazilian governmental institute, namely Seda, Anai, another one called Treble, those are missing market shares more and more in the space. The yields are not as high, the machines are not as adjusted for those seeds, the farmers are still trying to figure out how to avoid the sesame pod, the capsule from opening it. So K3 has just been getting more and more friction and tension with the farmers, and fortunately also with the international market. Where are we now? Now, the area in yellow, in the whole area of green, is what we call would be the equivalent in the US for the corn belt. This is where we grow a lot of the soybeans, a lot of the corn, and a lot of basically everything. In the northeast area of the yellow, in MT, called Mato Grosso, is where sesame has been traditionally and historically being grown. However, since last year, because of the window of climate and also for the high prices of corn, we lost around 50% of the same areas that we did the year before. That does not necessarily mean that we lost 50% of the sesame. What happened was, instead of growing to the same farmers that had sesame the year before and the year before that, we shifted to this area. So we had to take it from one area that was dry and already used to sesame with farmers that knew what they were doing, or at least they were the best ones among us, and we shifted to areas where the circle is. And these are the new areas. And this is being harvested right now. So as is very early for me to tell you, well, what was the aftermath? Did you get a very good outcome? Did the farmers do well? How big is your crop? We're sitting on it right now. This decision is going to be final in 1-2 months. This area that we're looking at is very new. A lot of new farmers, a lot of first-timers, they may not understand fully how the machine works, how to avoid the capsule from opening, how to losing seeds on the ground. All of our sales is machine harvest. We don't do hand pick. So this is very new. So we're expecting area-wise to have the same or more area than we did the year before. But in production-wise, because we're doing new farmers, being very optimistic, we're going to be around the same as last year, which was around 65,000. And finally, I was being told to do a buyer's expectations from Brazil. And look, I got to be honest. What are buyer's expectations if you're not very good, low prices, high fast freights, vast production, and speedy freights? I guess it's the same for every market and for all of us. We will be working to do it more and more, and we are working to get more and more sesame to everybody with the highest production ever, but it's unrealistic to match all of those for everyone. So, you know, we try. There's no panacea, there's no medicine for everything. We're learning on the process, and we'll be here for you whenever you need us, hopefully. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. That was a very good beginning. Thank you very much. Please wait as we finish with all the speakers, and then we will come invite you on the stage. The next speaker is Sudan. May I request Mr. Mamoun Ibrahim Gailey. Please put a round of applause in welcoming the chairman, Gailey Trading DMCC, Mr. Mamoun Ibrahim Gailey. He will talk about Sudan crop in 2022.
Good morning, everybody. First of all, I would like to thank our friends whom they make this meeting possible after very long times from COVID. So many thanks for them. We will start with Sudan scenario. Introductions, this year's Sudanese sesame is impacted by many factors, which including political and economic changes, container shortages, very high increase in the freight charges, currency fluctuations and floatings, and local prices change. Here in this table, we see the status of Port Sudan's ports. Port Sudan ports was witnessing a several decline in container traffic due to several reasons. Port in which global container shortage crisis, COVID-19 pandemics, in addition to tonnage nationally increase in the main issue of containers problems at Port Sudan. Also in the table we see the containers flow to Port Sudan for the years 2017 and 2018 for comparisons, which is shows the figures around about 220 and four comparisons. This table showing the cultivation area in the seasons 2020-2022 based on Sudan. In our region's Sinars, the cultivation area was 1,419,000, while in White Niles was 453,000 fadans, while in Blue Niles was 802,000 fadans, in Kassala was 350,000 fadans, in north of Kordofan it was 2,000,000 fadans, in south of Kordofan it was 1,658,000 fadans, north Kordofan is 428,000 fadans, south Kordofan was 958,000 fadan. In east Darfur was 338,000 fadan. West Darfur was 89,000 fadan. In middle Darfur was 269,000 fadan. On our famous area, Gadarif, the number was 917,000 fadan. The total cultivated at that year was 9,681,000 fadans. Total sesame export in the years 2019 up to 2022 total in 2019 was 494,000 tons, while in 2020 we had a very significant increase, like 50%. The total goes to 697,000 tons, while in 2020, unfortunately, we had a decrease in the export due to COVID and other reasons. The total was 364,000 tons. In this year, 2020, total up to June, the total is 254,000. Our expectation for the months of July and August is around about 40-45. The totals up to today is about 280,000 tons. This table showing the major exporters of sesame in the years 2021. China, as general, is the biggest. Total in that year was 46,000 tons, while India is 6,732, Oman is 430, Turkish is 11,143, Yemen was 6,154, Cyprus was 76 tons, while Greece is 380 tons, Jordan was 2,416 tons, Lebanon 6,799, while Saudi Arabia was 8,332, Syria was 1,164, Tunisia is 4,140. In the years 2022, also, we noticed China as biggest, 66,796, Turkish 11,790, almost same of last year. Saudi Arabia, also same number, about 5,730. India, almost same number, 6,121. Jordan has increased the numbers by about 100%, it is 4,602. Syria also is also double, about 4,326. Lebanon is 2,530. Oman is 6,447 ton. Greece was same number, 380, while Yemen was decreased to reach 187. These are the flow of sesame to our famous markets, it's Gadarif. In the years 2019, we noticed that the total flow of sesame to Gadarif was 119,000, while in the years 2020, decreased to 94,000. And then again decrease in 2021, 88,776. This year, the flow to Gadarif up to September is 77,757. This diagram is showing the same flow of the sesame to Gadarif. These are the export to China during the years 2019, 2020, 2021. The totals in 2019 is 171,000 tons, while in 2020 increased to 231,000. In the year 2020, here the table is showing 55, but actually it was 148,000 tons. These are showing the same. Conclusions, the planted area decreased this year by about 12%. Total planted area is 8 8,530,000. This area goes to cotton and soybean. In these years, last year's our productions in the years 2020-2022 was about 450,000 tons. It was having carried forward from the previous seasons, about 50,000 tons. Our local consumptions was about 80,000 tons, which is used in oil factories, tahini, and sweets. We expect that after this all, we will have a carried forward like about 100,000 tons. And this will make us in a decrease of productions by about 10% in spite of a good raining time and good weather, just because of decrease of land planted. So I hope that I explain for whatever there is.
Thank you very much, Mr. Memon Gailey. May I request you to kindly take your seat, then we will call you for the discussion a little later. Thank you very much, sir. May I now request Mr. Sebastian Andrew to come and present on Nigeria crop. All the presentations are over, then we will have a discussion on the stage. Yeah. Mr. Sebastian Andrew from Wing Corporation, he is with us. He will talk about the Nigeria crop.
Hi, good morning all. I'd like to thank Srivastava and team in bringing all us to the one stage. After the COVID, it was so tough. People were fed up using Zoom and video calls. It's great to see you all in person here. Yeah. So these are the topics which we are talking about in Nigeria. We can move to the next one. Yeah. The sesame producing regions in Nigeria. So basically there are two areas, which one is the northern belt, is the green one, and the central belt. Traditionally, the Nigerian sesame was traded as Kano type, which is called the northern belt. And the central belt was called as Benue type. Over a period of time, exporters started trying to sell as region wise. So now people talk about Kano type, Bauchi type, Yobe type, Jigawa, Gombe. So people started selling different region-wise cargo. The challenge here is the people expect, for example, Bauchi type cargo to be coming from the throughout the season, which is not happening. So, and we can see in the top there's a Niger and Chad, which is a neighboring country cargo which cross-traded to Nigeria and get exported. So these are the geographical cargo flow. We can move. Last season, we have predicted during the October 2021, the Nigerian crop is around 290,000 tons, which is lower than the previous season. It was low. And as of date, we estimate around 265,000 tons have been exported, and there might be some cargo getting exported in the last 2 months as well. The carryover stock is very negligible and less than 5,000 tons. Just go back. The last year, the price trend was, next slide. Okay. The season started above 1600 levels and it moved up to 1690 and it came down to 1400 and again moved up to 1500 levels. So these are the price range which the last year season cargo get traded. You know. The new crop, currently on weather wise, we are not expecting any challenges. So most of the crop growing areas, most of the places the cargo is coming good, with a little exception in the northern area. No pest or diseases witnessed or reported till now. there is a slight increase in acreage in the cultivation compared to the last season. And we are expecting a slight increase in the crop size this season compared to the last season. The first cargo which comes in Nigeria is called Taraba type, which started in small quantities in kilos, but it will take at least 2-3 weeks for the cargo to flow in a big number. By end of September, more crop will come. So we are expecting the shipments to happen on October onwards. Before that, it's too difficult to have shipments from Nigeria. The challenges Nigeria was facing is port congestion. It's always this issue we are facing for the last couple of years. Situation is more or less same. There are some improvements, but still the port Lagos is congested. The waiting period is so high. Previous season, we used Port Harcourt, but this season Port Harcourt exports might be less because the imports Port Harcourt has come down, which has increased the cost of operations in Port Harcourt. Availability of trucks, both locally inside the country as well as for the exports. There's an increase in cost on everything. In Nigeria, there's a shortage of fuel. The fuel availability of fuel also shortage. The gas which people use for utilities has gone up. Overall, the cost increase is there. This is not only in Nigeria, it's happening throughout the world. Increasing freight rates and surcharges. This is happening across the world, but Nigeria, this last season, almost all the lines are increasing the freights, and they are not giving any forward commitments for the freight rate, so it's very difficult for the exporters to have a commitment on the freight. They give maximum 30 days of validity. So that is actually hampering the exporters' costing. Reduced free days. This is also a big challenge, especially to China, where they were all struggling with the COVID restrictions. So the reduced free days is a challenge to Europe and China. Increasing the finance cost is increasing. Currency instability. So the currency was very volatile in Nigeria, and we expect to be volatile in the coming months also. So Nigerian elections are also coming in a few months' time. So the currency instability can create issues on the costing of the exporters. Increase in processing cost. So almost all the costs for the hulling or for the shipping, logistics, operations, everything has gone up. So the exporters, especially the processors in Nigeria, will have a tough year compared to the previous years. This season, our estimation is around 10-15% increase in the crop areas, which will result at least around 12% increase in the crop numbers compared to the previous season. But still, these are not the biggest number. 2 years back, Nigeria has produced more than these numbers. So the sorghum, maize, soybean, paddy, all are having good returns in the country. So again, as the Brazilian counterpart said, it's a choice of the farmers to which crop they have to grow. So currently, we are estimating around 325,000 tons plus or minus from Nigeria. So price, this is what something everybody will be looking at. What is the right price, what is the best price? We all were interested in the pricing. We are in the August, Nigerian crop is just yet to follow. What will decide the prices is the Chinese stock levels are high now. Pakistan crop is yet to come. Ethiopian crop, Sudan crop, Sudan also people is talking about less crop compared to previous years. So to have a price view, I think we should wait for one more month. By end of September, we should get a clarity for the price for the new season. But for the short term, the prices should be very stable. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir.
A very happy season.
A very concise presentation on Nigeria. We will have more questions from the audience. Yes. From Alpha Group, may I request Mr. Mustaqim Nagarwala to come on stage and give a brief presentation on Mozambique Crop 2022. This would be followed by a presentation online from Mr. Joseph, who will join online, but that is just after this presentation. Over to you, Mustaqim.
Good morning, all of you.
And thank you so much, World System Conference, to give this opportunity to all of us.
So, we are Alpha Group, Agros Gulf Holding, one of the leading grassroots level processor and exporter of the sesame and peanut. Below is the country where we are doing operations. In the East Africa, we are in Mozambique, Sudan, and Tanzania. Meanwhile, in the western part of the Africa, we are in Senegal and Benin. So let's start with the highlight of the current year, 2022 Mozambique crop. This year, 2022 Mozambique sesame crop was delayed by nearly 2 or 3 weeks. Normally, it starts in the month of May and September, but just due to some factors, it was quite late, you can say. This year, the Mozambique have the poor crop production of the sesame than expected, especially in the north zone. There are mainly two zones for the sesame in the Mozambique, in the central zone and north zone. But due to some reason, the crop was late for 2 to 3 weeks. As per our local operation source data, in the year of 2022, Mozambique have produced approximately 65 to 75,000 ton of sesame seed, which is nearly less compared to the last year, almost 25 to 35% less. And compared to the every year's benchmark crop or the last previous five years data, if you compare, the crop is almost 35% late, you can say. So there is, as I told you before, there are mainly two areas, north and central. So most crop production in central area is like Kaya, Buzi, Milanji, and the border of Malawi and Zimbabwe. But this year north zone reached sesame production area like Nampula, Namtili, Nithia, Balama, and had the poorest production since record of the last 3 years. These days, most area arrival are finished few area, little bit arrival. The main reason was the bug and the two cyclone was there in Mozambique. So just because of this reason, and there are also other some reasons which create the shortage of the crop, which we will see further. Till now, almost nearly 20 to 30% crop has been exported, but most cargo yet to be shipped due to the shipment issue and later arrival of the crop. And furthermore, most cargo are in the hand of exporter, which is under cleaning and under shipment. Even some of exporter are still short of the recovery, they are trying to finish their commitment. This year, Mozambique sesame forward trade started from 1480 CNF level, and till 1520 to 1550, lot of trade has been done in the forward. In between the price, when the arrival actual started on the ground level, the price jumped to 1650 to 1680 CNF level. Some way local bush price started from 77 to 78 meticais. And before export recover within a few days, it's reached to 85 to 88 meticais under pressure of short, because there were a news that crop is very short. So just because of that, this price were hike, and the local price was very high, and that create high cost to exporter, and most of them have booked with the negative margin. This year, Mozambican cargo most exported to China, and some of also booked to Turkey and Japan. Due to improve in cleaning quality, many cargo also booked to Japan. Mostly, if we see the Japan market, Japan people or all the Japanese buyers, they prefer to have more clean cargo and good quality. But in the recent year, if you see the Mozambican crop, the quality of the crop is quite improved. So nowadays, Japanese buyers are also much interested for the Mozambique sesame. Mozambique sesame stand almost same level with the Tanzania South. Tanzania South quality, and even some buyer prefer Mozambican cargo, especially in Turkey. Most buyer prefer this for the taste of Mozambique sesame. So nowadays, you can say there is a much more demand for the Turkey for Mozambican cargos. So this graph, bar chart represents the simple tentative production of the Mozambique for the last 3 years. And if you see the last 2 years crop, it is every year you can say it is quite decreasing compared to last 2 years. And this is the price level when the crop arrival was not started. Some people were started trading at 1480 level, but after still 1520 level, there were many buyers and traders were active to buy. But once the crop started at the ground level, the price was sudden hike because there was a news of the short crop. So market get sharp increase, and it was almost touched to 1700 level. And then after the crop arrival was in the middle, at the time the price was quite stable at 1650 level till this month. So let's have a look out for what was the main reason behind the short of the crop in Mozambique. Two cyclone was there, which has effect in the main production area. Rain was there in the major production area. Few area reported some pesticide issue. Some area also has reported damage due to the strong pesticide used to control the weeds. Many sesame area also diverted to soybean production instead of sesame seed due to the good profitability price and less effort in the production. Last year there was a very less crop in soybean, but soybean market was in a high demand. So just because of that, local farmer thought to better have idea to sow more soybean, seeing after the last year scenario, and this factor also affect the production for the sesame for this year. So let's have some also look out for the logistic and shipment issue. During the crop, local currency remained stable compared to USD, so it was a positive point for the shippers and the exporters. There were some issues for the transportation due to the sudden hike in diesel prices locally in Mozambique. Transportation price remained very high for the port cities. So from the bush area to port cities, all the exporters were paying much freight compared to last 2 years. So it was quite challenging for all the exporters. Bush raw cargo quality is better than last year, especially in admixture percentage. Last year it was nearly around 12 to 15%, but compared to the last 2 years, the 2022 admixture was quite less, so which was the plus point or the positive side for the exporters. Security problem and other issue are remain challenging, same as last year. Same every year in Africa, it's not easy to handle some local threat and theft issue. So it was same as like every year in Mozambique as well. There are mainly two ports in Mozambique for the sesame export, which is Nacala and Beira. And the congestion situation is much improved compared to the last year, where last year it was really next to impossible to get the empty containers. But this year is quite good compared to the last year. Nowadays, there is a CMA, CGMA, have a regular service at Nacala and Beira Port, and they are not able to provide empty containers to all exporters for sesame, especially sesame, I'm saying here, and other pulses exporter, which is biggest. Challenge nowadays at Mozambique, due to that, most of cargo are remain unshipped at the both ports. Like every year, there are also other commodity parallelly come with the sesame seed in Mozambique. So there are only one shipping line right now working mainly in both ports. Last year, there were three shipping lines majorly operating in the both port, but this year only one shipping company is operating. And for them, it is challenging to provide only containers for the sesame seed. So thank you so much, all of you. This is from my side. And once again, thank you so much, World System Conference, to giving this opportunity to Alpha Group. And once again, I would like to thank you from our director, Mr. Jahid, which is unfortunately traveling and not able to attend this conference. And once again, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Takim. You have done a wonderful job with 1 day notice. Thank you so much. Now we'll go and connect online with Mr. Joseph Zunda. He is the National Coordinator of Tanzania Agriculture Research Institute. He would talk briefly about Tanzania Crop 2022. Welcome to World Sesame Conference 2022. Request you to go ahead with your presentation.
Thank you very much. Hi, everyone. Okay, let me start presenting. I'm Joseph from Tanzania, and I'm going to talk about the Tanzania sesame crop export and trade. Just for introduction, Tanzania is one of the major producing country for sesame. It ranks among the top 10 countries. This is according to FAO. And we, in 2020, we exported 540,000 tons. And for this year, okay, let me share.
Yeah, we can see your presentation, sir. Please go ahead.
Okay. Thank you very much. So for this year, 2022, till August, Tanzania has exported 52,000 tons. And we normally have a warehouse receipt system whereby farmer do correct sesame, and then the buyers can come to take. So according to the information from the warehouse receipt system, we had only 52,000 tons. But this is from two regions, which is Lindi and Mtwara. These are the major producing area, although we have other regions in the Tanzania, like in Morogoro, Dodoma, in the southern part, the central and the northern part. So only rich amount is used for local consumption. It's only about 0.25%, which is produced and is used for consumption. But the more than 90% is for export. So it's one of the cash crop. And sesame market is sometimes through contract farming. This is just a short graph to show that sesame production in Tanzania is increasing year after year. And for 2022, we expect the land for production to be 799,000 hectares. And the expected was 1.1 million tons. But as I said, that we have the information from the two regions, and due to the fact that we have the informal system in some parts of the country, they do not operate under warehouse receipt system, so some data were not captured. The expected production, this is basing from the land we have, it was 38,000 tons. However, the actual production has not exceeded 70%. There are some challenges that has led to this. I'm going to talk it later. So the expected land is 799 hectare, and the expected produce of this. This picture is just showing the varieties of sesame that we have. We have a white sesame. Normally, this is the one which is being produced. We have a variety we call Lindi and Ziada. But also we have another variety, which is Mtwara 2009, is chocolate in Ikara. But the major one which is being produced and exported is the white seed Ikara. I hope you are here, or you're getting me?
Yes, yes, please go ahead.
Okay, so as I mentioned that the production was not went a bit down due to some challenges, and the special was due to the unexpected market price due to the effect of COVID. People did not produce much. And there is also lack of support for people to contribute to the research and extension service. The extension services, which normally help to assist farmer follow all the good agronomic practice. But also there are some cases of insect pest and the sufficient friendly technology. Sesame production in Tanzania is done by normally small scale farmers and is by hand, but many farmers are being involved. So the production using this hand hoe, we find that it is not very, very friendly. But there are some minor also challenges, like the poor agronomic practices to some farmers. And that's why we say that the support of farmer is needed there. But we also have the available opportunities in Tanzania, because we have very big land. We have enough land and which is fertile and is good for sesame. But also there is a variability of strong sesame research program and good policy, the peace and willingness of farmer to produce and to work together with buyers within the country and those who want to export. But also the leadership is willing to be involved in the business of sesame. So we have improved the sesame, which we expect that the production will continue to go up, because the available varieties are very good in performance. We have varieties that produce up to 1.5 ton per hectare. For sesame crop price expectation, we say that one is quality of crop, quality of the crop. The quality is standard because of maximum use of improved the sesame, but also the size of crop is quite, the production is higher, and the expected price, we expected the price of at least $1,600 per ton. These are the prices that may attract the farmers and will encourage farmers to produce more. Normally, when one wants to come and buy sesame in the country, it's very simple. There are few procedures to follow. It's just to come and register within the country that I'm going I would like to buy, and then you just follow the procedures within the country, which are quite very easy and can be followed. A few of this one is listed there. And what we, the expectations from the farm, from the buyers, is good sustainable market price of more than $1,600 per ton. Also, sesame quality standard. In Tanzania, we would like to see what are the standard required by the buyers, but also the quantity, how much are the buyers would like to get, so that the farmers will continue increasing and producing according to the demand. But also the preference, what are the preferences of the buyers? If the buyers put their preference that they like this in terms of quality and in terms of quantity, then this will guide and lead and encourage more production. So, we normally say all these expectations should be known before planting, because they will influence farmers to produce more. Having said this, I thank you very much for giving
thank
us
you.
This opportunity, and
thank you.
We will be there to participate. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Joseph, for joining and giving us. Please stay online as we move to the discussion after all the presentations are over. We have less time. We have only 15 minutes. Otherwise, like, you know, we'll run into the discussion time. We have three speakers to move on. I will request Mr. Mihir Parmar from Mamta Commodities to talk on India. This will be followed by a brief presentation on Pakistan, and then last would be Burkina. Then we will go into the discussion mode. Mihir, over to you.
So, good morning, everyone. It's very nice to see you after maybe 2-3 years later on in person. And I'm Mihir Parmar from Mamta Commodities. And from the outset, I would like to thank the Sesame Info Group for having this lovely arrangement. Let's move forward with our slide. So today I'm going to talk about on these following broad areas pertaining to Indian sesame seed market. I'm going to talk on Indian production and demand, the last season crop review, the upcoming crop outlook and progress, and the sowing statistics as well. Along with that, we'll discuss some trends and outlook, some of the buyers' expectations as well. Moving forward. So Indian production and demand. So Indian crop is cultivated biannually, once in summer, which is around May, and once in winter, which is around October. So, and moving forward, like the total production size for India in the past few years, I would say is around 500,000 to 700,000 metric tons per annum. And Indian crop has local demand as well, in addition to export demand. So the local demand competes with the export demand, unlike other countries. There is a large population in India, and they consume sesame seeds in form of chickpeas or halwa, as well as sesame oil is also very famous in India, so in the southern region. So both of the demands actually compete with each other. And we can see that the Indian production actually peaked around in 2011 with an export of around 383,000 metric tons in that year. From that end, it has been slowly or gradually has been decreasing year on year. In the past few years, it has been a bit lower owing to COVID and other issues that were going on, like ETO and PSED issues. But moving forward, I think it might get a bit better. So now let us review the last season. So in the winter crop in India, it's mainly from UP, MP, Rajasthan, Gujarat states, and a few southern states also produce the winter crop. For as the summer crop, it's produced in the Gujarat state, the West Bengal, which produces the double skin type, and the southern states also produce a good quality of whitish sesame seed. The production in 2021 winter crop was around 250,000 metric tons. It was mainly whitish and some of the brownish type from Rajasthan as well. And from the 2022 summer crop, the production was like about 100,000 metric tons from Gujarat, around 12,000 metric tons from South India, and around 150,000 metric tons was from West Bengal, which was a double skin type used mainly for oil crushing and hulling purposes. So along with that, I've listed out the prices of machine clean whitish sesame seed, and the prices are in INR, FOB Mundra port. So the prices are from the last season in winter 2021 till date. So we can see that due to the bad season last year in winter crop, the prices were decently high throughout the year. It has been hovering around, let's say, 1500-ish level almost throughout the year. When the new summer crop came, the prices had a bit of pressure owing to a good production in Gujarat state. So the prices actually had a bit of supply pressure, and the prices went a bit down. At that time, we had a very good demand from China as well as Iran, and a lot of forward contracts also were made during that time. And because of this, these forward contracts, there was a very good demand, very good prices were there. It was being offered lower than the market value. But those lower prices lasted for a very short duration because the demand outweighed the supply actually. So after that, there was a short covering rally along with the Korean tender obligations. The prices had seen a jump in, jumped a bit and rebounded to a higher level. So currently, Indian prices, I would say, is more around 1550-ish FOB level, Mundra port. So around those levels, India is, because local demand is also there along with the export demand. Export is not so much into parity right now, but local demand still accounts for a higher level. So now let's see the progress with the winter crop. So monsoon season in India started around in early July, and it covered the entire nation by, let's say, 2nd of July. We have seen major variabilities in the monsoon, and the weather has been really unpredictable. There has been dry spells in some region, along with very, very high rainfall in some of the other regions. Even as of today, there is like really high rainfall and flooding going on in Madhya Pradesh, which is the central region of the India. And it might really damage the crop, is what we can see from as of now. But winter crop is still in its very nascent stage. It's very it's just finished the sowing, so the crop is still standing, and it's too early to say what the actual production figures would be. And there is a lot of variability in the weather as well. So if the weather goes well and the crop doesn't see much damage, we can expect around 250 to 350 kgs per hectare of yield, which would give around 400,000 metric tons of output this winter crop. These are a bit of what you can say optimistic numbers, but as we know that last year as well, there was a bit of a damage because of the rains at the end of the season. Same could happen again this time as well. This time India is having La Nina phenomenon, which is going on in India, which is usually favorable for India with above average rainfalls. But currently there is too much of rainfall, so which is causing a bit of flooding, which is adversely affecting the crop as well. So now let us see the sowing in India actually. So we can see that, as I said, in winter crop sowing, like in the major states are Rajasthan, Gujarat, MP, and UP. Gujarat, in the past few years, have been decreasing their winter crop sowing. They are mainly focusing on the summer crop, which is the irrigated type. And Gujarat has seen around 27% decrease since the previous year to this year in sowing. Madhya Pradesh is doing very well as compared to last year, with 12% increase since the previous year. Whereas Uttar Pradesh and Rajasthan are somewhat similar level, but the sowing is somewhat relatively good. Average sowing this year we can see. So if the production is, if the rainfall and the weather is good, we can expect a very good crop output from these three states as well. So now moving on to the trends and outlook. So India is in dire need of implementing ways to increase production, actually. So India has been one of the leading player in the sesame seed market, and but the production in the past few years have not been that substantial, I would say. So maybe increasing the yield is one of the foremost factors for India to stay competitive. So for these, the strategic points to focus on is using new seed varieties, increasing the literacy of farmers, and improving the way to protect the crop against the climate change, which is very difficult to implement, but it's something that we have to look into. So although India has seen like around 10 to 15% contraction in the export quantity and around 25 to 30% decrease in the exports to EU, India still seems in a very good position in regards to trade. The economic currency, logistics, and the banking factors are very good in India compared to our other Asian nations as well as African nations. So all of these factors are relatively very good. Let's say the shipping is also relatively easy from India. The containers are readily available, although the freights are high. The currency, although it's depreciated a bit in the past few years, it's still controllable and predictable. So the trading becomes easy that way. And the banking also still, it's a bit strict now, but they are moving in the right steps by implementing a settlement in INR, and the government is also helping us in that. So in these regards, India is doing quite well. The ease of trade is quite good as compared to the other nations. So, and the sesame seed market is also a growing market, so there are always opportunities, and India being one of the foremost producing nations, they are in a very good position as of now, I would say. So buyer's expectations, so everybody knows the buyer wants the best quality seeds at the best price. In addition to that, the buyers from most of the developed countries like South Korea, EU, Taiwan, etc., they require pesticide-free cargo, and which is more and more difficult to find these years. To avoid the chemical residue issue in sesame seed, there are like two ways to go about it, which is, one is the difficult way, which is by going at the source, contract farming. India land is quite fragmented. The average holding of a farmer is very low, and let's say one of a farmer would have 1 hectare, 2 hectare, 3 hectare kind of land. So it's very difficult to do contract farming over there, but that's something that is being done as well, not very successfully, but it's still being done. And one other step is testing out the cargo at every step for pesticides, which is also being done when exported to EU and other nations. So, which is not as foolproof as doing for contract farming, but it's still a step in the right direction. So Indian hull sesame is also quite well accepted all over the world. Hulling technology in India is being, dry hulling technology in India is also being adapted, mainly for some buyers of US, let's say. The aqua-hulled sesame seed is still the foremost variety which is accepted throughout the world. The buyers quite prefer the whitish color of the seed, which is difficult to get in the dry hulling technology. And to reduce the risk of salmonella, steam sterilization technique are also being used in India, so to avoid the salmonella issue. Other value-added products like tahini and cold-pressed sesame oil usage also has increased in India, and the buyer is becoming more sophisticated, more health-conscious in India as well, so the adaptation of that is also is on the rise. So overall, I would say the sesame seed industry seems to be in a good position. Just the thing is that a few challenges needs to be overcome. That's it. So with this, I would like to thank you for
thank you, Mehir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Please wait for the discussion. May I now request Mr. Mahesh Raja Manglani from Mast Kalandar to give a brief overview about what's happening in Pakistan.
Hello, good morning. Thank you, organizers, for arranging such a wonderful conference, and it's good to see everyone after 2 years of COVID. So I'll be presenting the crop outlook of Pakistan sesame seed. This is a bit introduction of our company. We are into imports, exports, and we do exports of rice, sesame, pulses from Pakistan. So first I'll be going through 2021 crop summary, and as we see, last year we had some carry forward which was around 18,000 metric tons, and the crop was around 150,000 tons. And the exports up till July 2021 to 2023 were around 100,000. Border trade is around like 26,000 metric tons. The local consumption was around 30,000 tons, which is increasing every year. And we had a damaged crop, which was around like 12,000 metric tons. Coming to 2022 sesame crop status, well, this year we see a decline in farmy production, and we believe the production of farmy might be around 10%, and the hybrid production would be around like 60%, whereas the Sindh would be around 30%. And the harvested areas, plantation areas of farming were replaced by the hybrid. But due to rain, that significant area was quite damaged. So therefore, due to rain, the farming harvesting areas delayed up till end August, and the hybrid will fully fledged will be, harvesting period will be around like end August and early September. If there are no further rains, we believe the crop might be good. And Sindh will be harvesting in the October, and due to heat waves in June and July, the size of the seed is quite small, and the rainfalls have damaged almost around 25 to 30% crop of the hybrid. This year, the acreage and the yield is very low, which is around 200 kg per acre, and this is the sesame crop and price expectations. As you can see, we do not have any carry forward this year. Whatever quality was left, that was consumed locally in crushing and oiling, and most of them was exported, and it was done through border trade. The local consumption is increasing every year, and this year we have a bumper crop, which is around 200,000 tons, but unfortunately due to the rains, 30% crop is harvested, 70% is delayed, but out of 30%, almost 70% crop of hybrid is damaged. So, and we have the border trade. We believe the border trade might be around 25,000 tons, same as last year. The local consumption will be again like 28,000 to 30,000 metric tons, and damaged crop, let's say, will be around 20 to 30%, which is almost around 60,000. So if you have a crop of 200 metric thousand, so 60,000 crop is damaged almost. And these are just numbers which we predict to our personal experience, because this is not the right time to give the right and correct information. Well, logistic this year are very smooth. We don't see any issue in container availability. We don't see any issue in freight prices. The prices of freights are declining. We have availability of containers, shipping lines, and vessels from Karachi to everywhere, especially to China. We have around 3 to 4 vessels every month. And but unfortunately, due to unstable conditions in Pakistan, the fuel prices have increased, and the labor charges have increased, which will definitely add up the cost of production. And the currency in Pakistan is not stable. The rupee is not stable. It depreciated around 25% in a couple of months. So the prices are not stable. Whenever we quote, every day we have a new price. Well, coming to the expectations from the buyers always have high expectations regarding the quality and the prices. But this year will be a challenging year while exporting from the Pakistan, because we have different varieties, several qualities, because of the plant, because of a lot of rains everywhere. Still, there is a huge production prediction of the rains up till September. But if there will be no rains, the crop which will come out in early September will be quite good. But if there is any rain, the crop might get damaged more, and it will get pest attack. It will get more moldy. It will get more damaged seeds. And buyers are still worried about the quality. Currently, we are getting hybrid variety in which almost 70 to 80% crop is damaged. So it is very difficult to segregate the quality. It is very difficult to maintain the procurement locally. And there are different prices for different qualities. Well, there have been some trades since in last month as well, and a couple of weeks back, and last week as well. But again, the prices were declining due to huge and bumper crop. But again, if the crop gets damaged more, the prices will not go down, and it will remain stable between 1500 to 1600 levels. This year, we don't see any aggression from the buyers, and they were waiting for the prices to come down. But we believe the prices will be stable at these levels. Thank you, and looking forward to meet you next year as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mahesh. That was a very short and crisp presentation. Thank you very much. May I request Mr. Samuel Melke from Ethiopia? Yes, sir. Please. He's taking the place of Mr. Sese Asmare, who could not come. Thank you so much. And if you can make your presentation briefly.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Samuel. I'll present for you the UTP-NCSI micro preview and outlook for the year 2022. So the outlines for me are CSIMI crop summary, the first one, 2022 and 23 CSIMI crop status of Ethiopia, CSIMI crop and price expectations from buyers, the logistics, currency, and shipping issues. Expectations from buyers, I will present on these issues. So regarding CSIMI crop summary of Ethiopia, as you all know, Ethiopia has a very diversified agroecological zones to produce a variety of products, and it's a land of crop diversity. Mainly we produce oil seeds of which are sesame seed, Niger seed, groundnut, linseed or flaxseed, and rapeseed. We produce these oil seeds mainly in Amhara, Benishangul, and Oromia regions are the main producing areas of sesame in Ethiopia, but there are emerging regions which are producing sesame. Those are Gambella, as the southern region, and Somali region are producing sesame as emerging a place. So about 3 million large, small, and medium producers are engaging in producing sesame in Ethiopia. From the total production of sesame in Ethiopia, only 3% are consumed locally. Yeah, as you see on the map, the main producers of sesame in Ethiopia are the north western part of Ethiopia, but as an emerging region, the east part of Ethiopia, the south part, and the northwestern part are coming to produce sesame recently. Yeah, this one are Ethiopian sesame production and export showcase for the last 5 years. As you can see, production is increasing from time to time. So last year, as the Central Statistics Agency Authority of Ethiopia, there are 463,000 area was covered by sesame, and of which 347,000 metric ton was produced as per the Central Statistics Authority. So here are the sesame export performance of Ethiopia as per the Ministry of Trade and Regional Integration of Ethiopia. So as you can see on the graph, the production and export of sesame from Ethiopia are decreasing in a decreasing rate from 309,000 to 160,000. From 2017-18 to 2021-22, we are drastically getting down in exporting sesame. It's almost a 48% decrease from the 2017 year. So it's very crazy. So the carryover of Ethiopia from the last crop season was about 32,000 metric ton, and the last year average export price was $1,600 per metric ton. This was the average, but it was fluctuating from 1,600 to 1,700 USD per metric ton. So as you can see, the export destination of Ethiopia was stocked with Israel, United Arab Emirates, and China. These three countries alone take 60% of the destination for the last 5 years. Last year alone, Israel was taking the highest share by taking 52,000 metric tons of Ethiopian sesame, and the second one was United Arab Emirates for taking 29,000 metric tons. The third one was Singapore. China is replaced by Singapore because there was a technical problem in registering our warehouse to export to China. That was the problem that China was replaced by Singapore last year. So as you can see on the graph, Israel was the number one destination by taking 50,000 metric ton last year alone. The second one was United Arab Emirates taking 29,000 metric ton of Ethiopian sesame. The third one was Singapore by taking about 90,000 metric ton of sesame from Ethiopia. So these 10 countries are the most buyers of Ethiopian sesame for the year last year. So regarding the coming year's sesame crop status, as we expect, as per the Ministry of agriculture of Ethiopia data, we expect 551,000 hectares are about covered by sesame. From this area coverage, we expect 2.75 million quintal or 275,536 metric ton of sesame. It's about 5 quintal per hectare. I mean, the yield per hectare is expected to be 5 per hectare. So the carryover or the stock come from last year was about 31,000. As per the Minister of Trade and Regional Integration, the budget expected to jump by 26% from last year. The sesame crop and price expectation for the year to come is as the recovery of as the world is recovered from coronavirus by the year to come, there are improvements in movement from place to place. So we hope that there will be an increase in the demand of sesame. Having said this, people's assumption or expectation are increased regarding sesame consumption. So we hope that there will be a high demand regarding sesame. So in the year to come, the price we expect from Ethiopia is to be 1,904 level due to the fact that an increase in fuel in locally, there are a very dramatic or crazy increase in transportation cost, a very dramatic increase in labor cost, fertilizers cost are increased, so we expect 1,900 USD FOB level for the year to come. Regarding logistics, currency and shipping, due to an international increase in on fuel, the logistics cost will remain high, we expect. The starting of packing in container or containerizing locally, that will solve a very huge problem for us. That's a very good chance for us. The challenge of availability of containers locally, that's in fact the problem with us. So the last one is what are the expectations from your buyers? The issue of quality. As far as the Ethiopian government is concerned, the Ethiopian government is serious in maintaining the very good quality of sesame for the coming year. So we hope that we will provide a very good quality of sesame for the coming year. And the other issue is the default. This is a very serious problem both with the buyer and the seller. We have to solve this issue together, not only buyers or not only sellers. So we have to solve the case of default together. If so, we will have a good business together. We expect, and I hope you to expect, price will be volatile due to different reasons. Another fact is the logistics issue. Container are very problem to containerize cargos locally. If that is solved, we can manage to containerize cargos locally and we can ship it as smooth as we expect. These are the presentation in short. Last but not least, we will cordially invite you all to come to Ethiopia for an August assembly or conference on the 11th Annual International Conference on Pulses and Oilseeds, which is prepared by EPOSPEA and the Minister of Agriculture together with the Minister of Trade and Regional Integration. It will take place in Sheraton Addis from November 50 to 60. We are waiting for you to come there. See you, and thank you very much. Have a nice day.
Thank you, Mr. Samuel, for pitching in for Mr. Sesame Esmer. Thank you very much. At a short notice, thank you very much. The last speaker would speak on Burkina Faso. May I request Mr. Yempabo Kolidiati, who is the president of INTERCEP, to please come and share on the Burkina Faso crop. Mr. Paul will, thank you, sir. Welcome, sir. The president will speak in French and he will be, Mr. Paul will translate in English.
Bonjour, mesdames et messieurs. Avec votre permission, Je vais m'exprimer en français et mon collaborateur, M. Paul Massek, va reprendre un résumé en anglais. Merci.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for having me. I will speak in French and my colleague will translate.
Le sésame au Burkina Faso, importance de la production. Il faut dire que le Burkina Faso produit le sésame sur toute l'étendue de son territoire, avec plus d'1,5 million personnes qui sont impliquées. Nous sommes classés au 9e place mondiale de producteurs et 4e africain.
So, as you can see here, sesame is a cash crop produced everywhere in Burkina Faso, which is a country in West Africa. There are approximately 1,500,000 smallholder farmers producing this crop. It is the third most important export crop for the country and represents a little over a quarter of all exports from the country. And as you can see, we are also, or Burkina Faso is, the 9th largest sesame producer in the world and the 4th in Africa, according to 2019 statistics.
En termes de production, il faut dire que le Burkina a connu une très forte augmentation de sa production depuis 2011 et avec des pics, notamment en 2014, où nous avions dépassé la barre de 300 000 tonnes l'année, et en 2020, où on est passé à 384 000 tonnes pour l'année.
So as you can see, we peaked, our production grew and peaked in 2014, and then more recently, we've surpassed that, coming up to our total production level peaks in 2018, I believe.
Nous connaissons une baisse en 2021, plus de 384 000 tonnes, on est descendu à 180 000 tonnes en 2021, dû au contexte sécuritaire difficile et au contexte mondial aussi. Et pour ce qui est des perspectives pour 2022-2023, nous estimons que nous connaîtrons une production entre 150 000 et 175 000 tonnes.
We're expecting a crop for this coming year between 150,000 and 165,000 total tons. And as you can see, the price has varied quite a bit. That's due in large part to environmental conditions and security conditions in the country, which has caused an effect on our pricing and our productivity. The total price of 700,000 francs CFA in 2021-22 corresponds to approximately $1.07.
Pour ce qui est des destinations du sésame du Burkina, il faut noter que le sésame va principalement à Singapour et au Japon. Mais il y a bien d'autres petites destinations où parachute le sésame du Burkina.
You can see here the primary export markets, which are dominated by Singapore, Japan, Togo, and Ghana. Of course, many of these are export ports for the sesame.
En termes de prix, nous disons que, au regard de ce qui s'est passé la campagne dernière, les prix ont évolué entre 575 et 700 francs le kilogramme, c'est le prix bord champ, pour un prix minimum au producteur fixé à 625 par kilogramme.
So the price for the producer, that's the farm gate price, is about 625 francs CFA, and then we've seen a range of between 575 CFA and 700 CFA per kilogram in the 2021-22 season.
Pour ce qui est des prix pour la campagne en cours, les prix seront de stables à croissants. Et c'est l'estimation que fait l'INTERCEP au regard du contexte national et du contexte aussi international qui renchérissent l'acquisition des intrants agricoles.
Excusez-moi, vous pouvez répéter, c'est 300?
Pour la campagne à venir, les prix seront stables, voire croissants.
Ah, OK. So we're anticipating stable prices and possibly slight increases for the coming year.
Yeah. On peut passer. Voilà, les avantages du sésame burkinabé, nous en notons au moins 4, parmi lesquels la qualité des variétés dont nous disposons. Nous avons des variétés qui ont un haut potentiel, notamment en termes de couleur. Nous avons la S42 qui est majoritairement produite et qui est une variété pratiquement blanche et avec une teneur en huile assez intéressante, comprise entre 50 et 58%. Nous avons également la variété Bigaré qui a une teneur en huile d'environ 53%. Et sur le terrain, il y a une pré-vulgarisation de nouvelles variétés qui montrent aussi des teneurs en huile très intéressantes qui vont dans l'ordre de 56 à 58%.
And here you can see the two dominant varieties, the first being S42, which is a creamy white variety. That's the majority production, which has an oil content of 58% and a potential yield of 1.5 tons per hectare. The other variety that's quite prevalent in Burkina Faso is the Bigari variety with a 52% oil content. In addition to these two dominant varieties, we're also looking and promoting new varieties that are showing up to 56% oil content, which are being actively promoted.
L'autre avantage aussi, c'est qu'il y a une amélioration considérable de la qualité du sésame, ce qui se note à travers la pureté dont j'ai parlé tantôt. Nous avons, par exemple, pour la S42, 95% de pureté. Et il y a une réduction considérable des risques de contamination, surtout au niveau communautaire. Nous avons également un accroissement des ventes groupées, ce qui matérialise plus la traçabilité du sésame qui passe des producteurs aux acheteurs.
So over the last few years, we've seen a significant increase in quality and quality control in our production. In particular, we're able to achieve approximately 95% purity rate for our entire crop. This has also been accompanied by a noted reduction in contamination risks at the community level for pesticide contamination as well as salmonella contamination, and we've also been able to increase the number of bulk sales, which can support the marketing, especially during the current security situation where it's difficult to reach individual farmers directly.
L'autre avantage aussi, c'est une meilleure organisation des acteurs du secteur de la filière à travers l'INTERCEP, qui regroupe l'Union nationale des producteurs de sésame, l'Association nationale des commerçants et exportateurs du sésame et l'Association nationale des transformateurs du sésame. Et tout ça, ça conduit à une meilleure professionnalisation des acteurs directs de la filière et ce qui contribue à améliorer la qualité également.
As you can see, we've also been focused on improving production and professionalizing the sector, both in terms of production and marketing. Where additional work is needed is in local processing and value addition.
Nous avons aussi en termes d'avantages, un certain nombre de réformes qui sont conduites au niveau du pays, à savoir la mise en place d'un certain nombre de normes, notamment les normes sur la qualité du sésame, sur l'huile, et l'élaboration d'un cahier de charges qui situe les rôles et responsabilités de chaque acteur. J'en passe.
As you can see, we're also in the process of improving our standards and quality standards in Burkina in conjunction with voluntary certification as well as regulatory work, and we're very concerned about ensuring continued improvement in quality and the safety of the food when it comes to marketing and for human consumption.
Okay, et toute la filière est soutenue par un certain nombre d'acteurs et qui sont au niveau macro et au niveau méso, à savoir l'État et les projets et programmes des différentes coopérations que nous avons au Burkina Faso.
As you can see, the sector is supported by the government and a number of bilateral and non-profit supporters.
Je vous remercie et j'attends vos questions.
Thank you. Welcome your questions.
Thank you very much. Please stay on there. May I request all the 9 speakers to come on stage now as you come. May I ask all the boys? We will have a short discussion now. Now that we have heard each of the speakers, I'll request the moderator of the session, Mr. Sandeep Bura, to join us along with all the speakers. As I read out, may I request all of you to kindly come on stage. Mr. Pedro Sesler from Arbaza. Mr. Joseph will join online. Mr. Mustaqim Nagarwala. Mr. Sebastian Andrew. Mr. Samuel Melke. Mr. Maimon Ibrahim Gaili. Mr. Mihi Parmar. Mr. Mahesh Raja Mangalani. And Mr. Yempabo, kindly take your seats. This discussion will be a very short one for about 25 to 30 minutes. First, we'll have a round of question and answer between the moderator and the panelists. But be ready with your questions as we move around with Mike, so that and keep your questions very short. Introduce yourself, your name and your company name, and keep the questions very short. That's our request, so that we can have a very purposeful discussion. Over to you, sir. May I request all of you to please come on the stage and take your seat, please. Thank you. Everybody in? Yeah? Yeah, Mr. Joseph is joining online. So if you have a question for him, maybe you can give your questions and he will answer it also. Yes.
Thank you.
Over to you, Mr. Sandeep. Yeah.
Thank you, Watson. It's a lovely audience, and good to see you guys in person after almost 2 years. And I hope, the trade for everyone grows for the coming year. Time is short, so I'll straight away shoot the questions. First, we'd like to have a question for Petro. Okay, so first thing first. What is the current yield of Brazilian sesame crop?
Thank you very much for the question. To answer it, the best answer will be to break it down between every single variety of seeds that we have.
In general, just an idea.
Okay, so I don't have a specific answer also either, because it also depends on if we're doing this in the north, in the center east, and how we do it. But let's put it like that.
Okay.
We've had farmers that would do a 400 kilo.
Right.
And we have farmers that would do a 600 kilo.
Right.
But we also, unfortunately, have farmers that will do a 300 kilo depending on the rain that they get and when they do it.
Okay.
And this is assuming the 95% seed that we have, which is K3, the Brazilian white sesame seed.
Okay. Thank you.
It's still very early stages. It's not as professionalized as other countries. So a lot of farmers are still learning how to do it.
And then what kind of measures are you taking to increase the yield?
A lot of the farmers are first timers, so they're learning how to regulate the machines, how to take care of better, when to exactly harvest, when to exactly seed. They were learning the rain, and we're still learning how to do it. Of course, the government in itself is trying to develop a seed that can be machine harvest and give a high yield at the same time. Hopefully that's gonna come eventually, but we do not have that yet.
Perfect, thank you. And next question is for Mr. Mustakin.
Mustakin, if you could tell us a little bit about, you mentioned in your slides that the processing in Mozambique is getting better. So I wanted to, our audience would like to know what, how many plants are there that can produce, you know, 99 plus category sesame, and also how many hulling factories are there, and what is the prospect for future?
Yeah, so as we know, mainly 4 to 5 players is there who is preferring to make 99 plus quality. And mainly for the Mozambique, the buyers prefer just 99 clean, not like other origins, like 99 plus 1, because mostly this cargo go for the crushing, and some of the few quantity, you can say approx 25 to 30% quantity export for the tahina and the other products, and the rest of the product go for the oil, so oil industry for the China. So mostly 4 to 5 plant is there for the 99 plus cleaning, and 2 hulling plant is right now there, which is working. Previously it was there 1 more, but at moment for this year, I think 2 hulling plant is working. And for the hulling, everywhere, you know, the water is a problem. So sometime in Mozambique, the hulling plant also faced this water issue and something.
Okay. And what are the freight rates currently, you know, vis-a-vis the pre-COVID rates? Let's talk about China, just an idea.
So compared to last year, the, as I told in presentation as well, the only one shipping line is operating for China at moment, comfortably. So compared to the COVID, the freight is not, you can say, too much reduced, but it reduced compared to the last year, which is near around $150 to $170 in between for the main port for Qingdao and Tianjin.
And previously it was?
Previously, it was near around $180 to $200. Last year, there was 2 to 3 shipping line were working for the, okay, the same destination, Qingdao and Tianjin. So it was very, very to vary for each shipping line. But for this year, this is from the one shipping line which is operating.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next question is for Mihir. Mihir, I think you mentioned, I think, the summer crop and the winter crop figures. India is producing close to 100,000 tons of summer crop. So what are the steps being taken to increase the summer crop in India?
So the summer crop actually requires irrigated farming, okay? So because there is no rain during the, like, the summertime. So the winter crop is mainly the rain fed, which is the monsoon seasons are going on now. So there is enough rain in India. And the farmers in India, like in all the states, it's not very easy to get the amount of water which is required for the farming. But the Gujarat state has enough water required. So they are doing very well in the irrigated farming and are seeing much better yields because of that, because it's a more controlled environment. So I think the summer crop is the way forward for India in that aspect. Along with that, the way to increase the summer crop is basically to incorporate other states as well. So even our Export Promotion Council, IOPPC, they are also taking excellent steps in the MP, UP, Rajasthan states to introduce farmer literacy programs, to introduce them to push them to use summer crop. Grow summer crop over there. I think that is an excellent initiative, and that is the way to go forward, because these the farmers are the same. They have the know-how how to grow the sesame. They have worked with it for many years. So growing summer crop over there makes a lot of sense. The India is progressing at a very rapid rate. The problems which were there 10 years back are not present now. So over there, it's a very good opportunity to grow the summer crop.
And also in terms of quality, I mean, the summer crop quality seems to be much better than the winter, last couple of years at least.
Yes, yes. As I said, like, it's a controlled environment, a bit more of a controlled environment, because the weather due to the global warming is getting harsh and harsh. There is a chance of rain damage, bad quality is much more prevalent in the winter crop. Summer crop doesn't seem to be that way. Like, you can just put in as much as water as you want in the crop and get a more of a consistent quality in the summer crop.
Okay. Next question for Mahesh. Mahesh, I think you mentioned in the slide that the current yield expected is about 200 kilos. So what is the normal yield in Pakistan?
Well, last year and last to last year, the yield was around like 450 kgs per acre. But this year, it is around maximum side, we can say around 200 kgs.
So when you say the area has increased from, I think, what percentage the area has increased?
No, the area is same.
Area is the same?
Yeah, area is the same. People have replaced farmy with the hybrid.
Yeah, we'll come to that later.
Okay.
But my question still is, I mean, I think the cultivation area is the same and your yield has reduced from 400, 450 to 200, right?
200.
That's correct?
You know, the cultivation area in Punjab has increased. In the Sindh, it is same.
No, I'm talking about total.
Total area, it is increased.
It has increased.
It has increased.
By what percentage?
Roughly, let's say around 20-25%.
20-25%.
Yes.
While your yield has reduced by almost 50%?
50%. Yeah, it is because of the rain. We had huge flooding.
Yes.
And currently we are having severe rains all over Pakistan.
Yeah.
And there were a lot of floods, so the crop is damaged. Because of that, we believe the yield have go down.
Okay. And next question for you is again, what is the reason for the switch from farmy to hybrid?
Well, in farmy last year and last 2 years, there was a lot of issues of quality, such as FFA. The higher FFA, the pesticides, residue issues. So people have switched from farmy to hybrid, and even the farmers are getting more prices for hybrid than farmy.
Okay. Okay. Next question for Sebastian. Sebastian, we this whole ETO issue has given a lot of new horizon to the world. So we see a lot of exports of hull sesame from Nigeria. So I mean, we'd like to know what is the quantum of product being shipped out of Nigeria. And what are the future plans? I mean, there are new entrants in the market.
There's no correct statistics of hulled exports out of Nigeria, but the quantity should be around 20 to 25,000 tons.
20 to 25,000 tons.
With the last season. And it looks like it's increasing. And we are getting more, more investors in Nigeria to start hulling from Nigeria. More companies are coming to Nigeria.
More.
But definitely, the volume of processed cargo shipping out of Nigeria will increase in the coming years.
Okay. So, Petro, next question. You know, China is one of the largest importer of sesame. And Brazilian sesame till now doesn't, you know, have touched the Chinese shores. So what are you doing, or is there any talks going on between Brazil and China to open up that market?
I really wish I had a proper answer for you, but all I have is a bunch of rumors. And those rumors have been going on ever since I joined the trade, and there's been a couple of years.
I mean, as an organization, you might have some organization looking after your...
We do. So from the export minister, there's subdivisions, and one of them dedicated to oilseeds.
Okay.
And the same way they're trying to do that for sesame, they're also trying to do that for mung beans, they're also trying to do that for... They just did it for peanuts. But it has to come from China rather than it has to come from Brazil.
Okay.
We are open, and if China is listening, we're here.
next question is for... Okay, Mahesh,
One more thing is how many, again, hulling factories, coming back to the hulling factories, how many hulling factories are there in Pakistan? And again, do you see any future prospect for putting more plants or people are investing more money into it?
To best of my knowledge, there are like 8 to 10 hulling factories all over Pakistan. But we see many people are interested more and more every year in coming sesame business and installing up hulling factories, cleaning machines. And as we see, the local consumption in Pakistan is increasing every year. So we'll see in coming years more and more hulling factories.
Okay. And what any idea of how many, what production you are able to do at the moment? Be it local or export, doesn't matter.
The hulling factories?
Yes.
I think it should be around, let's say, one container per day, not more.
Sorry?
I think it should be one container per day, the hulling factories.
No, no. I mean total hulling in Pakistan, total quantity that
Pakistan... How much they consume?
Not produce. How much they produce?
I think maybe 10 to 12,000 metric
okay.
tons.
Okay. So next question, Mr. Samuel. We see the exports in Ethiopia has been decreasing for last couple of years. Can you throw some light? What are the reasons behind it?
Okay, thank you. As you know, the yield per hectare for sesame is 5 quintal, whereas the yield per hectare for green mung bean and soya bean is more than 15 quintal, 1.5. So the
For soybean and?
Soybean and green mung bean, yes.
Green mung bean.
Yeah, the area which produces sesame is also producing soybean and green mung bean. So the selling price for green mung bean and sesame alone last year was almost same. So people are interested to produce more green mung bean than sesame, that's the case.
Thank you. Mr. Yampabe, can I have the mic? We saw in your presentation that the area from 2020 to 2022 reduced a lot. Can you share your views? What are the reasons behind it?
Okay, merci. Nous avons vu que de 2020 à 2021, il y a eu une réduction de la production de près de 30%. Et la même réduction continue dans l'ordre de 10 à 15% pour 2022. Et cela est dû fortement au contexte sécuritaire qui oblige un certain nombre de producteurs à quitter leur zone de production. Et aussi, pour cette année, c'est aussi dû au contexte mondial, notamment la guerre en Ukraine, qui fait que les intrants agricoles sont devenus très chers pour les producteurs. Donc, il y aura certainement une faible production comparativement, surtout à l'année 2020.
Thank you. We've noticed a 30% reduction in production in 2020, and that's continued in the current year, and we anticipate it will continue at a rate of 10 to 15% for the coming year. That's largely due to the security situation in the country, whereby many smallholder farmers are unable to access their farms on a regular basis, coupled with the rising cost of fuel, fertilizer, and other inputs as a result of the war in Ukraine.
Okay. Thank you. Next question for Mihir. Mihir, everybody in the hall wants to know, I mean, the ETO situation in India, what is going on? I mean, things are getting better. Has something been done? It's been streamlined.
So, as per the rapid alert system, there has not been a single detection of ETO in the last 9 months.
which shows that India is really improving on its ETO stance, and there seems to be no issues with the ETO. The new problem right now is a bit of a salmonella, but that salmonella issue is valid for all the countries. Now, all the African countries as well are facing salmonella issues, but along with India. And ETO was one of the way to eradicate salmonella, kill salmonella, but new technologies like steam sterilization and extra are also quite helpful. And mainly cleanliness of the factory is also one of the deciding factor in controlling salmonella. So ETO has been a non-issue for quite a while now. The demand from EU has not returned as of yet because of the negative impact of publicity of India. Due to the ETO issue, India had completely stopped the export of sesame seeds to EU for a brief period to control the issue, which was a very good step, I would say, because there were a lot of back shipments. And instead of just to continue and have a band-aid fix, India stopped the shipments completely. At that time, a lot of buyers maybe switched to African origins, to Turkey as well, gained quite a substantial stake of the vacuum that was created by India due to non-shipments during that period of time. But now things have gone back to normal, and ETO has not been an issue for a while now.
Okay, excellent. So basically, you know, with I mean, that's a very, very nice thing that you told us. And I think if you see the shipments that you talked about, 8-9 months, we are talking about 30,000 to 40,000 tons. Okay. And with almost no issues, that means it's going in the right direction.
Yes, exactly. And plus, South Korea is one of the major buyers of Indian sesame seeds. And they take around 40,000 tons, 48,000 is their total requirement, 40,000 tons maybe from 35,000 to 40,000 from India, okay. Let's say. And they also have a condition for ETO, which is actually stricter than EU, I would say. And the cargo is not getting rejected over there for ETO issues anyway. They implemented the ETO policy right when it was an issue in 2021.
Okay, thank you. So next question for Sebastian. I could have only asked this question to you. At $1,500 CNF,
Mr.
China,
Gailey, please,
will you be a buyer or a seller? November shipment.
Shipment period. Shipment period.
November, December, okay.
We'll be a buyer. Sorry? We'll be a buyer.
We'll be a buyer. Thanks. Crisp and short. Thank you. So, Mr. Gailey.
Yes, dear.
How
first
are you doing?
First of all, I'm sorry. I was in discussion with China also conference in the same time now.
Yes. I know. So, how is the Sudanese port doing? That is everybody's mind. Sudanese port situation.
Sudanese ports. Sudan port, I can see that is going to better. There is a small problems of strike. We expected that to be finished maybe 2 days.
Okay.
Already solution is given. Mm. I hope that it will be finished today with regarding the health department, which is issuing the phytosanitary and fumigation certificates. Otherwise, there is an increase in the number of vessels coming to Port Sudan, especially we had from last January, and direct lines from China, which is give a very big relief. It used to decrease the freight from 4,000 per 20 feet container to about 2,500, which is goods. On the same time, we receive two, three charter vessels also, it makes the ports relieving more and more. I hope that in the new seasons, this such problem will be solved.
Thank you. And with situations like fuel prices, fertilizers, fuel prices, and everything. Are these the factors that can affect the sesame, you know, planting area in Africa, especially Sudan, I mean?
Yeah, but it's not only these things. Some of our farmers, they shift their planting of sesame to cottons and to soybeans. That is the reason the area is decreased. Mm. But otherwise, I think the position of fertilizers or other things is good. Also, raining is in time. Quantity of raining is up now is good. Yes. So regarding the plantations, we expect that a good season. But as I said on my presentation, that the area is decreased due to shifting to cotton and soybeans.
Okay, thank you. Next to Mahesh, time is short. Little quick question is, we have heard prices as low as 14, 60, 70 for CNF Chinese pot for the Pakistan origin traded. Do you see the trend going on like that, or the prices have changed anywhere in the last 1 or 2 weeks?
Initially the trades were more or less around like $1,500 and right. Later it's increased up to 1625.
You're talking about today? I mean, today or yesterday? No, last 2 days?
Last week, couple of weeks back.
Okay.
The higher range was 1625.
1625?
1625 to China.
Okay.
And last week and last to last week, prices went down till 1460. We see many sellers at 1460 levels. Even yesterday, a couple of guys from this conference were saying they still have valid offers around 1460 until $1,500. Mm-hmm. But again, since last 3 weeks, there is continuous rains. These local prices are increasing for good quality crop. So I don't think the prices will fall down.
Okay, thank you. I think we also have Mr. Joseph online. Mr. Joseph? Yeah. Mr. Joseph, we wanted to understand two things. One is, what is the yield per hectare in Tanzania, and what are the major markets that the Tanzania sesame goes to? Okay. Thank you. I think now we're almost done. And thank you so much, everyone.
Maybe a question from the audience, if there is any question.
Yeah, that's all from me. If we have any questions from audience, I mean, we are happy to take it.
Maybe a question. Yeah, okay.
This is a question for both Brazil person, Mr. Pietro, and Mahesh from Pakistan. So when you are talking about the yield, it is per hectare or per acre? Because I heard Mahesh by saying it is per acre, and I was not sure.
In Pakistan, usually it's per acre.
Per acre. So you are saying 400 kilos per acre would be around 1 ton per hectare?
No, 200 kg. Because
so what it was last year, you said 400.
No, last year was 400 till 460. This year is 200 kg, 4 to 5 man per acre.
4 to 5 man per acre. Man is okay. For man is 20 kilos in Pakistan, same as India.
40 kg.
40 kgs.
Yeah.
Okay. And what about Brazil?
Per hectare.
Per hectare. So 600 kilos, 400 to 600 kilos per hectare.
At the best. So then, if you want to put an average, let's make it 400 average per hectare.
So then, does it make sense to grow sesame in Brazil? Because I mean, the kind of lease costs that you guys are having.
That's the right question. That's a question every farmer does when they decide, and that's a question that we have to ask ourselves every year.
Mm-hmm.
It's driven by international prices. Okay. For some years, depending on the currency, it makes sense. Depends on the price of corn, it may make sense. Depends on the window that they find after they harvest the soybean, it wouldn't make sense. So there are a bunch of questions that they need to check.
Maybe they're taking it as an additional crop on the same land.
Right. And again, you got to think that Brazil, we have the equator hemisphere. We have people growing it on the northern hemisphere. We have people growing that on the southern hemisphere.
Okay.
Depends on the rain, depends on soil, depends on corn, depends on currency. Every year.
Just out of curiosity, what would be the leasing cost of a hectare of land in Brazil for agriculture?
I don't think
the leasing cost. The leasing cost for per hectare in for soya farm, for example. The cost of lease.
Oh, the cost of leasing.
Yeah.
So I'm on the international side of sales. I don't know domestically though.
Okay.
But you can reach out to us at the booth and you can ask that question later.
For sure. Thank you so much.
No problem.
Anyone else?
Thank you.
Yeah, I think we see a question there.
Thank you. My name is Abakar. I'm from Silvex International from Nigeria. My question is simply to the finalist. The most important thing is it seems to me that we've concentrated so much on how to morph and aggregate the entire production from all parts of the world. But coming from Africa, we have a situation of serious first harvest losses from the farm gate. And I think this is an issue that each and every stakeholder in the value chain should pay attention to. I think we should work closely with all relevant stakeholders, especially those in the industry, to see how we can help these farmers reduce the first harvest losses, because these first harvest losses sometimes goes up to 50%. Now, if we really went to increase the yield in the global market space, we have to do whatever it takes as players in the industry to support whatever technology that will come, that we can provide to help us reduce the first harvest losses, especially from major production belts across the world. Thank you.
Hello. I think he want to know how to reduce the spillage of the seeds, correct? See, in Africa, mainly the farmers are smallholders, and it's a completely manual harvesting. In Brazil, the yield will be high because they're using mechanized farming. So by moving to mechanized farming, you can reduce the spillage of seeds. That is the one.
Thank you so much. We will conclude with this, if with your permission.
Any further questions, anyone? No, I think we are good. I think all in all, I can say this is another sesame year. Nobody knows what's going to happen. Yeah, that's absolutely sesame year. Nobody knows what weather is erratic, rain somewhere. I mean, there are droughts some places, COVID, war. I mean, perfect sesame year. Welcome everyone, and thank you so much for.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Sandeep. A big round of applause to the team. May I request Mr. Sandeep Bura to do us the honor of presenting the memento. May I ask Hira to kindly, like, you know, take those mementos. Yeah, we will also, like, you know, give a memento. Mr. Sandeep, please, like, you know, hand over the memento to each of our speakers as we call. Just 1 second. With the memento, like, you know, can you please present the memento to each of the speakers? A round of applause to all our speakers. Thank you so much, Mr. Gailey from Sudan. Thank you so much, Mr. Samuel. In the last minute, you came in and then you really did a fantastic job of presenting what's happening in Ethiopia. Thank you so much. We would have Mr. Sese Efnare tomorrow, who's the president of Ethiopia. Thank you, Mihir. Thank you, Mr. Sebastian. Mustakim has done a fantastic job. And again, it's a last minute one because yesterday we got the news that Mr. Jahid is not well. So thank you so much, Mr. Pesky. Thank you. Yes, so the moderator may request Mr. Tarun Chawla to kindly do his own representing a moment or two, Mr. Sandeep Pura. And then thereafter, there is a group photograph. Then, like, you know, we will take a short break. We have exceeded our time quite a lot, but I think, like, you know, we need a break. We have been sitting for 3 hours together. But I would request you to come back in 10 minutes' time. Thank you, Mr. Sandeep. Thank you very much. And a group photo with all the team members with the mementos. And then we break for coffee break.